Can I ever buy it up? Can I ever buy it up? Can I ever buy it up? A burning desire.
It's the first Bruno Mars.
Inside my heart, honey, can't buy you love, can't buy you anything. Money can't buy you love, buy you.
It's your boy Willie B. We're here. Tonight is a very special night. This one's gonna be a little different. Judas and the Black Messiah. Powerful movie. Based on a true story for sure. They dropped the soundtrack for it. So Willie to the rescue. Man, you gotta feel some type of way after seeing this movie. You know, it definitely evokes a lot about the time that we're in currently. I love it when new movies come out about figures in history, especially Black history, because a lot of our history is hidden from us. And it's like, we don't know how it happened. And these are reasons why we don't know, because these stories were erased, you know? So when we get a chance to see a movie like this, we get a little more light on not only our country, but, you know, us as Black people, our history. It's a powerful one. Released under RCA Records, which, you know, big wig Sony Music. Thank you, Sony, for putting, you know, money behind this. I like soundtracks because you kind of get the best of everybody. They sit the artists down. They make them all watch the fucking movie before, you know, anybody works. Usually, this is traditionally how it works. They sit them all down, make them watch the movie. Then they get inspired. Then they throw them in the fucking booth and go make some shit. So that's why I like soundtracks, because it's usually a focused effort.
Heads up, eyes open, the fist clenched.
Yeah.
This here be the chairman, Fred Hampton Jr. Direct. See, now I need y'all to bear with me as I bear my soul.
Before we get really cracking, I love that they actually used his actual voice, just his speech. I think that's powerful. You know, you want to hear how he actually spoke, how he talks. They put the rhythms behind it and the vibes behind it, which is cool. After watching the movie, you wanna get a... start this off with his words and his philosophy and how he see things, you know, because it is poetry, you know, it really is. He's a poet, you know. He used his poetry in a different way. He wasn't just fucking making songs. He was putting together speeches to move people and actually get something done. COINTELPRO, wow, this is the actual hit. This is the name of that project that was carried out in the movie. He spoke about it before he died, you know, and all the greats usually do. They like, you know, and a lot of people say they just spoke it into existence, but it was already happening, you know? They just saw where it was going. This is good to see. I love the sample. I love her's voice. It's good to see her on here. No pun intended. This might be the sweetest way that somebody can say, hey, let's work this shit out and let's not wage war. Just put a beautiful young Black woman out there with an angelic voice and just say, we don't want, that she's just singing, please, let's not fight. What he said, what Chappelle said at the end of it, we can't figure this out. Rat, ta tat tat ta tat.
We back in business. I visualize what it is, not what it isn't. We at the mafia table next to the kitchen. Eating Michelin star, counting a million. Look, hood theories.
He got us a hip hop album now. Nas just stepped in the building. Hip Boy came with him. You know, he brought the backpack and the laptop. Nas coming with that sporadic shit, talking about how niggas that came up. He said they ain't broke no more now. It's a little different than what you saw on the movie. He's just talking about rat culture. There's so much rat talk in that movie. You know, the Judas. Judas is the biggest rat ever. That's why everybody shuns 6ix9ine, because it's like, nigga, you just a fucking backstabbing ass motherfucker, man. You the Judas. That's why that story in the Bible rang truth throughout. There will always be a Judas. It's somebody who's gonna tell. The streets is always watching, and that's usually streets rule number one. So you always got to move a certain way, because people are always watching.
Streets, welcome to America.
The sins that a father, my pop, gave me to suffer. The friends I will follow was crack babies and hustlers. It's still sharp and still in the block. Made me a cutler. My pen is from the future like Octavia Butler.
He's a masterful rapper. He's so on point, and he just sees it. He's a scope artist. He's a sniper of a rapper. Now, Black Thought is the perfect person to have at the helm here. He could have played that motherfucker himself. Ever since Black Thought came out, I always thought he was a revolutionary because he was putting these type of quotes into his raps from Jump Street. This nigga always speaks knowledge. He really understands the essence of hip hop and what it is of knowledge moving, you know what I mean, in rhythm. You know, it's a beautiful thing. He's just describing the pain. He didn't even, Black Dog didn't have to watch this movie to fucking submit this verse. They just tell Black Dog, hey, Black, we're doing the Black Judas shit. Speak about Judas and Black shit.
It feels like.
The
only reason I survive
because
a nigga is special first.
First of all, RIP to Nipsey. All of his rhymes give me chills because he's in the breath of these niggas who spoke before it. You know, he knew. And Nipsey's one of those guys who was making these type of moves and talking that type of talk that Fred Hampton was on. That's why all of this shit is full circle. That's why I'm really glad that they got a Nipsey verse for this project. It's wild to hear him talking how he talking, you know, because he always been spitting that shit and about Black unity and trying to get us all together. That's what his music always been about. That's why Jay-Z bought 100 copies of his first project just to prove to him that, like, young nigga, I see what you're doing. You like a young me. You understand it. That's why we give light to rappers as soon as we possibly can, because all rappers are speaking the truth. And it's probably uncomfortable for most people. You know, but we gotta have that freedom because it's the last line of defense of truth because everybody else selling out. And if you don't have fucking rappers and comedians, y'all fucked. You know? Well, he letting you know, first and foremost, that he has lost all of his respect and hope in the government, which is tough. That's wild to hear from Jay-Z. And that's big, and that means that he's probably creating something else. A lot of people are in business with Jay-Z. They know his business acumen, but he owns a lot of his stuff now. You know, he's no longer like anybody's slave. He don't have a boss. He is married to Beyonce, so they're like They're really the Black Kardashians out this motherfucker. Martin Luther King got, you know, super high, and that's why we revere him. And I was just talking to somebody that, like, he has an opportunity in his lifetime to make his legacy something insanely crazy, you know, in the breath of a Martin Luther King or a Malcolm X without being killed. That's the biggest thing. He's a billionaire, and he's making rap music. Rap music don't make that nigga a dime. So the reason why he do it has to be big. When a billionaire decides to rap on a song, you listen to that shit. He just put it in the open that he's selling weed, man. That's a big discovery. And he said he bringing his folks home from the feds. Everybody knows a big story right now. A big conspiracy with him bringing home the CEO of Roc Nation, which I just discovered. I just had to dig into this. This is new information to me that Trump was the reason that she came home. So that means Jigga went to work, man. Jigga went to work. He said, I got to get my CEO out of here. If I'm Jay-Z, hell yeah, I'm selling weed. Jay-Z's definitely in the pocket of every fucking president. He is an influencer. He is a part of the 1%, you know. He's at the Black caucuses. He's at the luncheons. And that's probably why Kanye might fuck around and be president after Biden. It sounds far-fetched, but Trump sounded far-fetched. He was born on the day that Fred Hampton got shot, which is very wild. Is it a coincidence that such a prolific poet was born on the day that they killed Fred Hampton? For what I saw, I just saw the movie, and the way they fucking assaulted that man, to know that Jay-Z was born in a fucking mossy project, and if he does actually have this theme to really evoke change in this world, to the irony of him being born and him rapping on this album, you know what, 40 some odd years later, is fucking ridiculous, man. The masterful painting by Sir Jigga. Every time he put one out, it's just a PSA. And I look at him in the same breath as I look at Dave Chappelle. Whenever these niggas want to come out and say something to us, we respect them because they give us the look behind the curtain. They're going to let us peek a little bit. And that's why we fuck with them, because we can trust them. It's a trust factor.
I should A&R the game, pick you niggas beats. Honestly, I sent hotter shit to your email. Tedious with the detail, picking the pocket apart, calling the blitz, getting looks from them.
Hit boy. Shout out to Hit Boy, because you're an amazing producer. You're a cool rapper too, but like he just had to get on it. That's every producer though. Every producer is like, man, if I'm gonna make the canvases for y'all niggas, I got to spit me at 116. I'm gonna get mine off in this COVID season, nigga. He not even talking about Black Power, none of that shit. He just like, nigga, I'm gonna flex on these bitches on this joint. Fuck all the bullshit. Yeah, we fuck with Fred, nigga, but y'all need to party real quick, nigga.
Silent, please.
Whenever I see Smino coming, I know something's dope coming. This is a little different lane for him. He's never really had to be off his motherfucking super empowerment shit. But I like it. I like where he's going with it, because he's saying some shit right here. I gotta even bring this back. Smino is too fucking smooth and cool, man. This nigga, he said that. Because the way you start a fucking verse, it matters. You know, the way you come into a song, the way you say whatever the first thing comes out of your mouth. Whether it's the words you're saying or how you say it, Smino is a bit of a super, super genius on that. He's like, he's confused a little bit. I'm here. I love everybody. I want to love everybody. But like, y'all telling me now I got to be fucking segregated? Like, what kind of shit is this? You know, like, this is the feeling of this verse. Smino's dope. If you don't know who Smino is, go listen to him. Go support that man. Super dope artist. And then Saba come in off some shit just talking about the cops living above the law, man. And that's, you know, if you look at that movie, man, that's a clear example of that. You know, it was almost like these people didn't have any conscience of what these people were really trying to do. One has a badge and one is just trying to live a life, you know, and be free and free other people. And it's like, okay, you might could be free, but you can't free people that you love. And that's crazy. J.I.D., I love J.I.D. He understands the plight. He understands the vision. I know that he studied this story because he could speak very fluently in the perspective. He's very brilliant. I'm glad that we have a J.I.D. He's one of my favorites. Rhapsody is one of my favorite female MCs, for real. Definitely top five favorite female MCs. Fucking Rhapsody, bro. This woman here, man, she is a dog on the mic. She's so cool, man. and she's always been revolutionary talk. She definitely would have been in the Black Panther movement if she was born in that time. She'd just been rapping on the front lines, trying to rap for freedom out that motherfucker, man. She is so dope. This is very good casting for this album. Masego. I love Masego. I fuck with his vibes and shit, so he's a good, like, soulful voice to bring on here just to, you know, bring it all home. I've never heard BJ the Chicago Kid. Ever. This is my first time ever hearing him. I didn't know, you know, this nigga sounds like Bilal and D'Angelo. He's one of those artists for me that you have fucked up from the name. You don't think you're gonna get this type of record from him. I didn't even know he was a singer. I thought he was a rapper, but I'm familiar with his name. I had him fucked up. He's like a way more soulful Mario. If you know who the singer Mario is.
Thing made me safe as a pill to take a nap. Hoping it's a dream, but it's facts. He ain't Ricky, so no bullets to his back. A trench baby waking.
You know, somehow, like, I don't feel like Lil Durk watched the movie, but this record still works because it's the mindset of a nigga just going through a lot of crazy shit, and that nigga has been through a lot of crazy shit. So, this record definitely works. And, I mean, this feel like some shit he could have just threw on the album. This is kind of a big record, and I think a lot of these artists are using this as a little platform to like be like, yo, you need to come listen to the album too. Because if I heard this on a Dirk album, I'd be like, hell yeah, Dirk, it's a dope ass record.
Black skin, black as the space, black as the ash on the blunt, black as the pavement, black as the spade, man. We are made, man. Roots go deep, we never caved in. But how can you appraise?
I'm like, sizing your shit up too, boy.
Hey, man. I love it, man.
Hey,
you know it, bro.
Yeah,
that's how you got to do it, bro.
I'm proud of you, bro. Because look, that's all it's going to take is that first step, bro. Just taking that first step.
I don't know who White Dave is. He sounds like he might be white, but I think he's talking about that black struggle right now. So seems like he knows a thing or two. Well, I can't call you white. That's an ironic name you got there. I guess maybe, I don't know, man. I like that, man. I like that. You got me fooled, White Dave.
Close because it's never the right time. They gonna die for me like a lifeline. They gonna ride for me for a lifetime. And they slide with me like right now.
This is my first time hearing G Herbo. I'm familiar. I know his face. I've seen an interview with him one time. His voice is unique. Kind of this spider-esque type of flow. It's different. I can see why he's got a fan base. Not really my favorite flow. But I can see people fucking with that flow. The beat is okay. I don't know what it is about like certain horns on beats that turn me off. Some people might like it because it's like the Royal Queen type shit, but like, I don't know. They turn me off.
Us, I declare war on whoever that won't end us. Seem like violence is the only way to make the fuckers feel. I declare war.
I just like the griminess of the beat. This is the last line of defense. Yeah, don't even bother this nigga until, you know, shit is apocalyptic out this motherfucker. Really, this is when this nigga should come out. Other than that, we gonna keep you in the tuck. You're like the nuclear, with the nuclear button. That's the red button. That's what this song is. It's some goon-ass shit, but I like it. This is definitely War Baby music. This is what you bump to go commit some crimes, baby. This is all you wanted right here. No, but he's speaking real, though. He's saying, you know, we tried everything. You know, like, I mean, we tried the peaceful route. We tried Martin Luther King. We tried the X. We tried to do all these things. Peace protest, all this shit. This is when all hell has broken loose. Yeah, Nardo Wick. I never heard of you, man, but shout out to you on this. When we need the war cries, I know who to come to. We're going to come right to you, Nardo. Put your gun down for right now. We don't want you getting in no trouble, Nardo. You just chill out, all right? It ain't time for you, Nardo. Yeah, this the war section of it. this the war section of the album. Pooh Shiesty, don't know about you. You know, this is he kind of got that sound like Gucci, got that Gucci flow. I didn't hear a curse word. I'm running it back. We gotta get to the bottom of this. I gotta give it up for this guy, Pooh Shiesty, man. And see, I understand because I'm a rapper and I know how it goes, you know, like to really say some profound shit. A lot of these rappers out here is just phoning raps in and they just curse for no reason. And it's like you still have some slapping shit and talk some street shit and you don't have to curse. And the name of the song is No Profanity. And actually, if you listen for it, it makes you listen to his lyrics more. So that's why I really like it. It's like, it's a dope little record now. Like, you know, I'm forced to hear it again. And the stories he's talking about, he's basically just talking about why he don't trust the police. He's not even one of the wildest niggas. He's actually a good person to have on the front line. Because he's just saying if it gets crazy, of course we're going to bang. But nigga, let me tell you why I'm just not trusting them niggas. Like, why I already didn't trust the pigs and fuck the pigs. This is a heavy fuck the pigs record.
Revolutionists just fucked the ops, ignore the peace. Died in the hood, he never left for so much more to see. Heard the news about him, really hurt me to my core for weeks. The other side and 1200 while we explore the streets. Jealous of my melanin, what make you human more than me?
See, you getting a pulse of how the young people feel, man. And this is indicative. You can't gloss over these records because this is how these young people feel, man. They feel like, what is a motherfucker to do? You get here And the shit been the same since, like, your grandmothers and grandmothers, great grandmothers is telling you the shit, and you reading history and seeing it's like it got to change. We need that energy, but we need to refocus. You know, we need to move together and move smart, and move in the right direction. And that's how you actually get things done. Of course, when you look at that movie and you say they've played unfair. They came in and just assaulted everything, you know. So you don't meet the fire with the fire. That does nobody no good. That's how we all die.
After catching big homes on my masters, I have to let it be known that I rose to all challenges. Raise my status up and broke all averages.
Dom Kennedy, this West Coast influence. They had to bring in some West Coast vibes. And Dom, it seemed like Dom didn't even get the message. Seemed like Dom didn't even know this was a movie. He said, I'ma just give you these LA vibes. This is an album cut he just gave to him. He's like, oh, y'all giving up some bread. But thank you, Dom. This is a dope song, regardless. I appreciate the vibe. It ain't all gotta be so militarized music, you know. You could just throw vibes on the joint. We all just wanna hear some good vibes too. So thank you, Dom. Your role is important on this project. This is G Herbo. Dog, you bringing it on this one. I fuck with your flows on this one. And I already said it before, he got the voice. He just could switch it up. He could switch his flow pattern to make him seem like this type of rapper, and then he pop out and give you some super lyrical shit. Cause he's very poignant on this, and this is different. I thought it was Sahi the Prince. I had to look at this. I was like, oh, that's okay. Bump J. All right, Bump J, I see you. He held his own. He definitely held his own. I fuck with that. He was very unique. You know what I mean? I had to follow where he was taking me. He took me on a nice little journey. I got to learn a little bit about him. That was cool. Yeah. Thumbs up. Dope beat. I know this sample. I know that Kanye sample. You know what I mean? I can hear that joint in the background. Sir, you know he gonna bring a whole tribal reggae type of vibe, man. He's really musically inclined, world musically inclined, you know. His ear is like off some Akon shit. I really like him, and his voice is so unique. He's burning up the streets. If you don't know about Sir, man, get on his album. One of them spacey feel good songs. You got to get a feel good record on there somewhere, and it's good. You know, it makes sense for them to put it at the end. I've never heard of Safe, nor have I heard of Keanu Letty. So you know, this is like showing off people that you might not know, and people with those little niche followings. I love Keanu Letty's voice. She really sounds good. She kind of brought it home for me. The Safe guy's dope, but she kind of brings it all the way home. She got a very unique voice. It sounds like a couple other people, like a mix between a few people, but I'd like to hear some original records from her.
Drink champagne, but you order the cases. All your friends hanging because they know that you pay it. When the bill's backing up, and black ain't enough, and them checks adding up, you just don't want to be famous.
Give me some new ASAP, man. I'll take me some new ASAP on this album for show. Yeah. Need that. This feels good. This feels like vintage ASAP. That shit that I like. You know, he always parappa the rapper out here. They put a bonus track on there. Put a OG out. Rakim. Yeah, now this is this is older Rakim. You know, he's still bringing them hardcore 80s flows. You know, his words is what matters more, and he's an icon, so you ain't about to see me do no type of say nothing crazy about Rakim. Needless to say that the album concept and theme is super high for me. It definitely resonates, obviously. And a movie like this gets everybody thinking, and gets everybody thinking about the problem as not just a black problem, but as a humanity problem. and this album will help it. It's hard to go anything lower than a 10 because it's so needed, you know. And a project like this is it needs to be out. You know, people need to know complete truths just so, you know, we can get facts straight. And the way we teach, you know, these type of movies actually teach history. You know, this type of movie will be taught and, you know, they'll show this in little kids' classes one day. Artwork, I'm not going to get too touchy on that. I mean, it's pretty simple. It's based on the movie. And this album cover is basically black. You know, it's just to remind you, man, to remind you that all my lives matter. And, you know, when you forget about a certain hemisphere of people, you know, you become forgotten. You know, and your everyday wants and needs become forgotten. If I had to rate it against other ones, it's not the greatest, but the symbolism is very high on it. So, I mean, I'll give it a 9. Production. Hit Boy. Now, Hit Boy actually did his thing of keeping his thing as a cohesive project. It's a storytelling type of album. It's a journey with it. It's definitely higher points and lower points, you know, in terms of a story arc. The beats and canvases were wonderful, man. Very melodic, very soulful, very tribal sounds. Took me 2 days, but we got through it. And it's tough, right? It's tough to put production like this together because you're dealing with so many different high-profile artists. And so I have to give him a lot of credit for being able to rein everybody in and kind of keep everybody in a direction. It's dope. It's hard to do. He was on his young Quincy Jones with this. So we'll definitely give we'll give production an 8. Creativity, pretty high. You can't have so many dope artists on this thing and the creativity bar is not high. I've heard in a range of flows. This is a action-packed album of an artist, so it's hard to critique this one low. A lot of creativity on here. A lot of people took chances with their rhymes. Creativity high for me. We'll definitely go for 8. There's a lot of takeaways from this album. I feel like a lot of these artists use this album as a launching pad for their year. I feel like, you know, they's like, yeah, let me sneak a single out on this, which is always a good idea. I'm never against it. Every artist should try to do that, especially in times like this COVID where checks is slowed up. You know, it's very distinct artists who speak about the struggle on here purposely. And then you got artists that you didn't expect to hop on these type of topics that tackle these type of topics, which made it even more valuable to listen to. And then you got the Jay-verse, you got Nas, legends who graced the presence of this album and lended an updated version of how they feel about things, which is always a plus. To the Game and the Culture is also high to me. You know, needless to say, just because of this cultural art event that describes the past, and describes the future and the present. You know what I mean? We have to get a hold of this. So this album couldn't have come any more on time than it did. A 10, dog. You know, it's made for the culture. Lyrics, what are we talking about here? Any album that involves Jay-Z, Nas, fucking, come on. Dom Kennedy, fucking ASAP Rocky, Smino, Nipsey Hussle is on 2 records. It's like lyrical content is very high. This is like a cheat album, so it's definitely gonna get a 10. It's amazing. It always pushes the culture, and this is a big one. It's a big release for 2021. Of course, I mean, it's a stat stuffer, and it's for the cause. This is like a charity album for real, so no drum roll or anything needed. It's a classic. It's a classic album. I'm rating it in the album. It's unfair. It's not fair to even really rate this, but since we gotta put it through the numbers, it scored a 66, which is a classic, hands down. You know, it's too many records on here that's gonna stick with people, and it's too early for this thing to really even get its full acclaim. But people will look back on it and be like, man, it was some some powerful records on there. This was fun. If you haven't seen the movie, go see the movie. Get HBO and fucking look at the movie and do your think pieces and all of that good stuff. And hug a neighbor, kiss somebody, buy black, and you know, do all of that good stuff. That's it for me. You know, it's been fun. I love you if nobody ever told you that. We will reconvene and call the next play. I holla.